Hello, it's Keith here. I wanted to just show you today something I'm working on. This isn't a lesson. I'm not going to be teaching any assembly, but this is a set of tools I'm creating that I'm hoping to be able to make available to everyone. I wanted to show you them today and see what you think of them, and hopefully your people will be interested in it. So what is it? Well, basically what I've done is I've taken all of the tools and scripts that I'm using to develop the multi-platform Chibi Akkerman's game. I've simplified them, I've added a few extra things, and I've built them into a little beginner's compiling environment for simple development on multiple systems at the same time. So what I'm hoping to do is make this available to you so you can download it. And what you'll do is you'll end up with an archive with a folder in it called Learn Z80 Dev. Go in here. And then there's a file called ZedDrive. And what this does is it creates a virtual ZedDrive via the sub command. So as long as you don't have a ZedDrive on your machine, this will create a fake one. And that allows me to configure all the emulators as if they'd been installed on the ZedDrive, so that you don't need to install any emulators or anything of your own. You can just use this and you should be completely fine to develop for multiple systems without any installation or configuration. So let's have a look at what we're doing. So we're doing all our assembly in WinApe, as I usually do. So if we just have a look here. So we've got this Hello World program for starters, and what it does is it prints a hello message and it waits for a key. So it's got all of the similar functionality to lesson 4 that I just did. So we'll start off by compiling for the CPC. So we do assemble and we get this little message here, and it says type call and 8000 or type run go. So let's do that. So if we do run go, now this assembly script will actually compile and save straight to the disk. So there's a disk image here, and by running go, we get our hello world message. And we can press a key and just see the key returned. But let's just prove the point. Let's change the hello to goodbye. A bit more negative maybe, but let's give it a go. So assemble, and it's run. And then we do run go. So it's changed to goodbye world. So you can see that I've just made the change, and seconds later I can see the result on the Amstrad CPC. But that's probably not that impressive, because we've done CPC development before, but we're just getting started. So let's semicolon out and rem out our compiler directive for the CPC and enable the MSX one. And now let's compile again. So there we go, we've compiled and we've been told to run msxgo.bat. So let's find that file. msxgo.bat, and you'll see this is loading OpenMSX, which is a free emulator. All of the emulators and all of the tools in this are free. So there we go, it's opened, it's loaded a ROM file, and it's run our compile program, and it says goodbye world. So you can see, and now I'll just press the A key and it's worked in exactly the same way. So there we go, we've compiled to two different systems in about 20 seconds. Let's carry on. Get on a roll here. So we'll rem that out. And we're going to compile this time for the TI calculator, the TI-83. Now you're probably thinking, why on earth have I supported a calculator like the TI-83? Well, the TI-83 is a bit unusual compared to all of the other Z80 systems. The TI-83 is still in production. This is a current generation system. I also thought it'd be a bit fun to support a handheld system. So maybe people have written a little program they're quite proud of. Well, now you can have it in your pocket, so to speak. So that's why I've done the 83. It is current generation and it is handheld. So we've compiled there. So all we do is run that script here, and it loads WabbitEmu. And there we go. You can see we've got our message here. I'll press a key. Now the keys map slightly oddly. They don't map to ASCII. They map to symbolic numbers. But the program does basically work. Now one limitation with WabbitEmu is because it's a current generation system, I can't provide it with ROMs. I'm going to have to remove the ROMs from this. But it's fairly simple. If you've got a ROM, all you do is you load the ROM in. You save a save state file about to run the program called program, and then you just run it exactly as I've shown you. Once I've got things set up, I will provide another video on how to set up WabbitEmu from your own ROM file. But anyway, you can see we can compile straight to that. So let's move on from the TI and let's see the Spectrum. So we've just compiled for the Spectrum, and we've got three files we can run here. We can either run a plus three disk, which is the Amstrad plus three systems, a TAP file, which is tape, or a TRD. So let's run the tape first. And there we go, it's run. Goodbye world. I pressed H. There we go. Let's exit that. And run the disk. Exactly the same. And TRD. Goodbye world, you see. Now, I mean, maybe you don't think this is particularly impressive, but I'll just point out, it took me a long time to figure out how to build TIDs, how to make workable tape files, how to get the emulator set up to do these things. So I've kind of hopefully saved you the time if you want to create a simple program, or if you want a foundation structure to build your program on for all of these systems. You can use this as a starting point. You can use the tools I'm using. You can use the scripts I'm using if they help you. If they don't, then you can write your own. Anyway, moving on from the ZX, the last one I've got is the Enterprise. Now, the Enterprise is very similar to the CPC. It's a Z80 system. It's got a graphical system that is kind of a superset of the Amstrad CPC. It's more powerful than the Amstrad CPC, but it can do pretty much everything the Amstrad can. So I only came across it fairly recently, but it is very interesting, and I'm considering porting my TI-83 game to it just because it's so similar, it would be very easy, and it is a system that has some quite impressive features in places. So anyway... So we've compiled for our enterprise and we need to run ent.go. So here it is. Goodbye world. And I press G. So as you see, we've compiled to five different systems, even three different disk systems on the spectrum. One program, all of those running away. But let's just show you something a bit more interesting maybe. So I'm recording this straight after I just showed lesson four. So what I'm going to do now is, you can't see it on screen, but I've got lesson four here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy and paste the code of lesson four down to the bottom of here. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to change call print char to call show hex. So what we're going to do is we're going to show the hexadecimal value of the key the user printed. And the reason I'm doing this is I want to show you that once you've got this multi-platform template, you can put completely different code in and it will immediately compile to every system you've got. And the reason it works is that there's a bit of a trick, and I will explain it in just a moment. So we're going to do the assemble, and we've got no errors, which is a good start. So we've just compiled for the enterprise because that's the directive that's still there. So let's try it out. Goodbye world. So I'm going to press A and it says 61, and I believe that 61 is the character A. I'll just check that. There we go, so it's working. So we've just compiled that for the enterprise, but that's not, it's only the beginning of obviously what we can do, so let's try it for something as crazy as the TI-83 calculator, which is our most basic system. And here we go. So I'll have to take its word that the keys don't match hex ASCII characters. They've got their own numeric values. So yeah, it's a bit odd on the TI, but that's the way the hardware is mapped. So let's try the MSX. There we go. So I mean, I think you can see the benefit of it at this point. I've just written a program that I've never run before on any of these systems, but because I've only used assembly language Z80 directives and the functions that this toolkit provides, it immediately compiles on five different systems without any testing or debugging just fine. So hopefully this will be something that's interesting to people. Now, the way it works is I've put these header and footer includes in, and also a functions command, and you'll also see I've got a start, an init, and a shutdown. And what these are is the compiler directives at the top are used by those scripts, and they pull in, they enable and disable the correct functions that those systems need. So the new line command will work correctly on each of the systems. The get character command and the wait char character command I've reprogrammed them for all of those systems. Now, obviously, if you were going to do more advanced things like sprite drawing, you would need those functions as well. This is really just intended at this stage as an example of how to compile for multiple systems a basic hello world function. You would have to develop your own modules on top of that, but my plan is eventually to start teaching people large sections of the TI-83 game, which does compile for the Spectrum and the MSX and the CPC. It will never compile for the TI, it isn't possible. I would like to make it compile for the Enterprise, but as I say, basically, I'm planning on building on this. If people are interested, if people use it, I will add more functions to all of the systems up to a basic point. And if you really want to get advanced, Chibi-Akamas will be open source once it's finished. So you can take the entire game, you can take parts of the game, you can rip my disk routines, rip my sprite routines out of the game, and you'll have a good foundation to compile onto multiple 8-bit Z80 systems, and you'll be able to use this development environment as a starting point to get you developing code as fast as possible and save you from having to figure out how to do it and how to get the tools working together. So there we go. I hope maybe you found this interesting. Maybe you're impressed by it. Let me know what you think. As soon as I've got this at the point where I'm satisfied it's working reliably and it's not going to cause me problems because it doesn't work and people complain about it, I will try and make it available to people. But please bear with me. It is a complex. There's a lot of script in here, and I've obviously got to test it with different operating systems and things. It's Windows-based, of course, but the difference between Windows XP and Windows 10 when it comes to things like environment variables and things can be quite problematic, so I am having to test it quite thoroughly. Anyway, thanks for watching today. I hope you found this interesting. Goodbye now.